A barbecue with Italian fishermen, a Mediterranean winter warmer, and easy peel oranges on BBC Two shortly. Here on BBC One, a look at the weather. 40 years of it, from studios where things aren't always as they seem.
Hello, do you want to do some weather?
Oh, shall we then?
Yes.
Okay then, let's do it. Okay,
go. You can do it, we can help. I get paid for it.
The person that you see presenting is the only person in the system. The forecaster is start with a forecaster. He's the graphics artist. He's the presenter, the director, the floor manager. The camera's even bolted to the wall, would you believe? And at night time, we even put our own makeup on. We are a one-man band.
World Service Television for the World, version A, 4:30 GMT, Wednesday the 15th of December 1993, take one. The title is Europe. The title should say Wednesday the 15th of December, Rob McGowie, meteorologist. If it doesn't, well, I can only say I've tried.
It's raining men. Hallelujah, it's raining men. Every specimen. Tall, blind, dark and mean. Rough and tough and strong and mean.
Vision and sound are on. The station goes on the air.
Hello, Radio Olympia. This is direct television from the studios at Alexandre Paris. And now I'm going to see and hear someone you know well.
The world's first television weather forecast was transmitted by the BBC on Tuesday, the 3rd of November, 1936, at 4:01.
These readings were taken at 7 o'clock this morning.
It lasted for 6 minutes, during which time an anonymous hand drew isobars on a map, while a disembodied voice read the forecast to the accompaniment of a little light music.
It's expected to reach London about 4 o'clock on Sunday morning. This rainy air.
The first on-screen Met Men were across the other side of the Atlantic chart, where charmers like Canada's Percy Saltzman set a benchmark for clarity and state-of-the-art graphics.
And here is the forecast, which I'll write down for you if you can see it. Cloudy throughout the weekend with snow flurries, I'll abbreviate them SW, snow showers, with colder tonight and milder again on Sunday. Colder tomorrow as well. The low tonight, 25 degrees. The high tomorrow, 32 degrees. And that is the hurried up weather picture to this minute.
Well, Percy, when you give it to us that way, we really don't mind it.
By 1954, Belgium had TV weathermen, so did Holland and Germany. And finally, the BBC allowed the Met Office to invade our screens.
Hello, good evening. Well, after a few quite exciting days of weather, today's been a bit nondescript, and that's rather disappointing for this very first occasion of a Met Office presentation. Anyway, behind me here we have...
My name is George Cowling. I'm a retired meteorologist. My only claim to fame, or if you like, notoriety, is that I presented the first live television weather broadcast on BBC 40 years ago today.
I'll now reveal the forecast chart as we see it for midday tomorrow. And there it is. These two lines here.
The BBC was very keen on what they called the cult of the personality in those days. The Meteorological Office, representing the civil service, wasn't nearly so keen. We were just civil servants to them. So we had to be careful in what we said. And in fact, all our broadcasts were monitored back in the London Weather Centre, and you got a quick telephone call if you said anything out of place.
And if you didn't get your washing dried today, get it out early tomorrow, before that rain comes in.
And it went down extremely well with the press, in particular when I mentioned that it was going to be a good drying day the next day. Nothing like that had ever been said on television before.
But the good news, for soccer fans at least, is that for the FA Cup replays, tomorrow night and on Wednesday night, there'll definitely be neither frost nor snow. Well, I'll be with you again at the same time tomorrow evening, but I'll now leave you with a summary chart of tomorrow's weather. Good night.
I had said that the rain was going to reach the west coast of England round about lunchtime, and would you believe I had a telegram the next day from a gentleman in Liverpool saying, rain arrived 1 p.m. Congratulations.
It was an age of innovation. The French employed art students to paint Picasso clouds on panes of glass.
How to avoid an emotional involvement.
The Americans gagged it up with snappy one-liners.
Early to bed and early to rise, and girl goes out with six other guys.
But the BBC stuck to the tried and tested expertise and natural charisma of the Met Men.
Here with the weather forecast is Bert Ford.
Cold front, fairly lethargic, quite slow moving eastwards, and it's going to take quite a while before it clears the area. In fact, if we go across now to tomorrow's midday chart, it's still very much with us, just moving across southeastern districts.
By the late 60s, the weatherman had gained a special place in our hearts and a permanent, if sometimes precarious, hold on the schedules.
I accepted the fact that the weatherman was a piece of elastic and he had to stretch or contract as was expected of him, providing that the contraction wasn't too great, because Britain is a very difficult place to forecast from. You can have as many as four or five different bits of weather over the country at any one time, and so you need a minimum amount of time. But I didn't mind, providing we had a minimum amount of time, stretching it, because there's always something easy to say about the weather, something more to say about the weather.
Dotted about here and there.
The 70s brought further innovation, and not a few problems, both in menswear and in the new magnetic rubber symbols.
Fairly thundery with some, oh dear, these let's do it again.
But the most radical innovation of all in 1974 was Britain's first weather woman, Barbara Edwards.
Up till now, with radio, one hasn't had to worry about what one's wearing. Nobody sees you. But, of course, this is quite a change.
But you are giving your wardrobe some careful thought.
Oh, I certainly am, yes.
We had the microphone and all these leads, and was it an adapter or something? It was a thing about the size of a torch and then a thicker wire. All had to be sort of hidden away somewhere, and I used to tuck it into a skirt waistband. A few times when I wore a dress, there was nowhere to put this thing, and I'd forgotten all about this till the other day. The wardrobe came up with this pink garter, which to strap round my thigh, and it had little loops on it, so I could thread all these wires down through my dress and stick the amplifier adapter in and into this garter and then sort of wander up and down with this.
The BBC wasn't the only channel to be creating weather stars. One day, a young meteorologist with a new style and fresh ideas left the Met Office and walked into the studios of Thames Television.
Autumnal mists. You can see the satellite picture behind me.
You needed to be able to communicate with viewers, and if you could do that, that would be half the battle. Body language, pictures rather than charts, perhaps a more ordinary approach. I didn't get sort of fan mail. It was kind of more mail sort of saying, my God, what are you doing on television, you know? Surely you're out of your depth, or are you sure you're in the right field there, you know? I remember David Essex asking me, are you really a meteorologist or a failed actor?
In 1983, we decided that we would start to get the weather team to be personalities, that we would develop each individual and the skills and styles that they had. It coincided, in fact, with the computer graphics coming in, and it also coincided with me taking over the team.
So, 10 seconds of grinning weatherman.
Only I forgot to start, didn't I? Sorry a minute, hang on. Take two.
What we're looking for when we look for new presenters is certainly the it factor. Have they got it, have they not? And if I had to sum up what it was, it's personality. Do they come across the set? Do they, when you switch on, grab you? You know, do they come out from the set and make it interesting?
In this room, they're auditioning weathermen, taking trained meteorologists and putting them in front of a camera to find out whether they have box appeal. John Kettley, Suzanne Charlton, Bernard Davey, they've all been through this. They had it.
Well, good morning, everybody. Look at the weather for today. Western Scotland and Northern Ireland...
Hello. Very cold last few days. Welcome to this afternoon's weather forecast.
Were you nervous? Not particularly, no.
Should be.
There's a character about you, and quite often that's what they're looking for. They're looking for a character, somebody with a big nose, somebody with big ears, or something about them, and there's something about your stature that sort of does give you a bit of character. But unfortunately, you didn't boom it out to us.
So, I would say, go outside, but wrap yourself up well, and that's all for me.
And remain mild, and that's all for me.
I've been working sea temperatures at around minus 11, and even UT is high as plus 9 with the warmer air coming up from the south. That's all from me. Have a good day.
When you got to the end, you know, you would have good end. You'd one of the best outs that we've seen, sort of turn it, sort of have a nice day and a big smile, and that was fine. Whereas most people sort of die a thousand deaths by the time they've got to the end. They're exhausted, you know, they're spent force and nothing left. It's sort of, you know...
When you go into the studio as a broadcaster, you've got to be this extrovert, this showman, and put on a show for everybody. Because this is what it is, it's a show.
I don't know, it's Mike.
Yes, hello, Mike.
No. The news is threatening to overrun by about 6 or 7 seconds. Would you be happy to work to an off-air time if we guarantee you a minimum of 2 minutes?
No.
No?
No, I've too much in it. I've got a film crew in here filming as well for a programme later in the year, so I'd rather keep it to as it is, if that's possible.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just another little problem. Sometimes you have to deal with, you know, wanting to shorten the time or lengthen it.
Good evening.
Nearly all forecasts are delivered live, and they're always unscripted, with no autocue to ease the flow or floor manager to give moral support.
Smile on my face isn't because I'm expecting wet and windy weather. It's just that I'm happy to be here. But now I've let the cat out of the bag. Let me show you where the wet and windy weather's coming from, and it's spreading mostly to Northern Ireland and Scotland. Good evening. The smile on my face isn't because I'm expecting wet and windy weather. It's just that I'm happy to be here. But now I've let the cat out of the bag. Yes, we are expecting.
The true secret of their popularity can be found in the weather forecasters' gestures.
For the rest of the country...
Weather forecasters rarely stab or point or poke. The hand is always relaxed, the arm balletically curved.
It's all about geography. It's all about caressing your chart behind you, you might say, having this liaison, this relationship with the chart.
Banks of cloud are coaxed, stroked, caressed. These are not the detached gestures of an unfeeling expert. This man is a lover, in love with the atmosphere, the maps. There's even a sneaking affection for the clicker. And there's a shyness in the way the hand withdraws, a slight embarrassment that too much may have been revealed.
To a certain extent, there maybe is a weather style for the way that people actually present the weather story of what's going to happen. But in some ways, it's maybe because it's a little bit incestuous and that we all train each other. So it's awfully easy when you're starting off a new job and somebody's training you on the job to pick up little phrases that they have, little ways of doing things. You do it subconsciously.
I wink. I've got a 1 second wink, a 2 second wink, and a 3 second wink. And the 3 second wink is saying a very good night to you, and I do that until the time runs out. Now, Bernard Davey, on the other hand, he started to wink. This is the problem, of course, if you train people, they pick up your own idiosyncrasies.
Well, that's the forecast. Bye-bye for now.
And I had to call him in and sit him down and say, well, look, Bernard, you've started to wink at the end of the broadcast. We can't have that. You know, one winker on the team's enough.
Hello. Or should I say, hi there, guys and gals.
Good morning and welcome. The temperatures today don't expect... That was dreadful.
Ian has taken the personality into cult figures, and he has presented a few problems in that if you don't watch it, that one person could swamp the whole team. But if you're made into a cult figure that may, and I'm not saying he is, would end up as a buffoon image, then it destroys the whole object of you being on television to do the weather forecast.
In Albuquerque,
other
right
forecasters
now,
in other lands disagree. In their attempts to turn weather into entertainment, they're willing to jettison dignity, good taste.
Don't worry.
The overnight low, 78 degrees at 6 a.m.
And even vocal chords.
It was still 80. Hello, North Brunswick!
Here are a few tips for weathermen trying to stay this side of buffoonery.
Don't allow stars onto your floating map. And don't trust your camera crew on Guy Fawkes night.
Now we're going to whiz around this afternoon, so watch your back.
In the studio, it's equally dangerous to allow visiting guests to share your map.
60s and 70s tonight. It's getting nice and cool, but still hot out west. Big heat wave out west. 90s and 100s building all the way up into Washington State and Oregon, and still rather uncomfortable in the southeast.
The winds today, we can lose us from the screen now while we continue, are very light and from the west.
There can be quite a lot of rivalry in the team, which I encourage. And if I sat down and said to them, who's the best person on the team at the moment? If they all didn't say they were, I wouldn't want to know them.
I believe I'm a pretty slick presenter in my own way.
I don't think I'd be doing it if I didn't think I was good at it. I think you've got to have a certain amount of ego and self-confidence to do it.
As well as ego and self-confidence, they also need to be dedicated.
Colder weather come in with wintry showers, particularly for the north. And in case you're wondering, the last time we had a properly white Christmas was over 20 years ago. That's all.
At 9:30 p.m., the day shift do their final broadcast and hand over to the night shift.
Good. I'll run through it then.
How big is this freezing rain threat?
From now until 9 o'clock the following morning, one forecaster handles the world's weather. Alone.
Snow, good.
But I don't think I'm going to lie too much, he says before he goes home.
Hope you got that on camera.
Yes, he can take the flak if it goes wrong. Here comes
the rain again. The late hour weather hound tracks the hurricanes in Hartford, Hereford, and Hampshire, and sniffs out the sleet in Sligo, Salford, and Slough. Having turned his isobars and Amiga blocks into sunny spells and scattered showers, by radio and television, he alerts the world.
Hello again. The unsettled weather looks set to continue for the next couple of days, and it will turn progressively colder. And then on Wednesday, it will be risking a rumble of thunder. And by morning, some black eyes to watch out for. Well, that's it for now. I'll be back with you in the morning. Till then, good night.
London sleeps. Television Centre is deserted, mopping up the leftovers of the day's game shows and soaps. But he must remain watchful. In London, it's 4 a.m. In Hong Kong, they're just knocking off for lunch. In Vancouver, it's happy hour, yesterday. The BBC World Service Radio and Television now provides satellite forecasts for the deserts of Iraq, the mountains of Afghanistan, the steppes of Russia, and the great wheat fields of Canada.
Hello again. Winter is beginning to set in across the Atlas Mountains of northern Algeria. Recently, temperatures have been as low as -3 degrees, and that's 3 degrees below average.
If it's cloudy on Kilimanjaro, or there's a spice-scented breeze blowing down the Silk Road to Samarkand, Our boys and girls are on the case.
It's further south that you've got to come before you bump into gale force northwesterly winds blowing across the Sea of Japan.
They even dress for the part. Every one of them keeps a light linen World Service jacket on standby. When reporting tropical heat waves, after all, stout winter tweeds are not on.
That's a look at the weather around the world. And I'm going to put my World Service jacket to bed. Good night. I'm off then. Cheers, Penny. Bye.
Good morning, Penny.
Good morning, Cathy. Yes, we've got a good deal of cloud over the country at the moment.
The specialised language of the weather forecast is compelling. The mantra of the shipping forecast, the familiar litany of sunny periods and scattered showers and top temperatures, make it a significant moment in our everyday life. Francis Wilson, for example, has made several notable contributions to the forecaster's vocabulary.
One I was thinking of the other day, which I'd want to use but not had the opportunity, is snert. Now, I mean, this is just the classic. You combine two words, right? So you know how when it's snowing and everything is Charles Dickens and it's a Christmas card, but then, you know, a day later, all the cars and it's all got really black dirt and snow. So I thought snert, you know, that's a good one. I'm trying to use that one day, but enough of it. So you can do it with others, mist and drizzle.
Now, say a very good morning to Ian McCaskill.
Good morning, Nick, and it's grand to be here.
We've got some pretty peculiar weather around at the moment.
These lumpy bits are
miserable, ugly, blustery showers.
But by the middle of the day, all those spits and spots in the wind will
scoot off into Scandinavia.
And then tonight, we're all going to end up windy and eventually
bitter,
but probability of it happening is zero.
A good time to do the grass.
Thank you.
Weather forecasters. You either love them or hate them.
Dear madam, as an English language student, what the devil is muddy?
Gabbling Gertie drives me up a wall with a high-speed strike. Suzanne Charlton to slow down.
Dear Mr. Cockroach, if you talk again about a decent amount of rain, I shall come up to London and stamp on you. Did your mummy never explain to you?
A cold, dismal day. This northwesterly wind blowing
you by... swine! How dare you do this to us?
I'm just doing a weather forecast.
Oh, it's all right for you, isn't it? Standing in a lovely warm studio, dishing out horrible weather over the night's pass.
This is the BBC.
Shut up, you!
I think to make a good television weather presenter, you need to have an awareness of what the people want to hear. You've got to be able to speak to the public at the same level, not try and talk down to them. You haven't got to lecture to them. That's the worst thing in the world you can do. You can't patronise them. Treat them as adults. Treat them as intelligent people.
Hello. Yes. What? Yeah. Yeah. It's going to be very nippy. Yes. Yes. Yeah. Going to wrap up warm. Yeah. Yeah. Plenty of woolies. Yeah. You can't be too... you can't be too careful. Yeah, well, it's getting colder these days, don't you think? Oh, much colder. Yes. Well, bye-bye. Yeah. Look, I'll pop round in the morning, all right?
I think the letters, we like getting the letters perhaps from elderly people who are at home, you know, and we are a contact. Mm. Well, they're on the screen live every hour, and they write rather nice letters to us.
But you're sort of their friend.
I think we're company.
Yeah.
And we don't use a lot of bad language, and we don't wipe our noses on our sleeves, you know, and we're in the front room.
Do you ever get romantic propositions?
Not for a week or two, David. No.
Francis, you're still as gorgeous as you were when you first started. We'll miss you very much. Good luck. Hope we don't have a bimbo replacing you.
In the 70s, one of the fashions was things called tank tops, these little sort of slip-overs you wear over a blouse. And one woman wrote to me and said, who do you think you are, a woman of your age wearing tank tops?
And in the weather world, that's the way the wind blows. While a male forecaster can make a fashion statement with a new woolly pulley, as soon as a woman appears, the F factor is on the agenda.
Men seem to be able to get away with a lot more on television. There's a lot more older men, perhaps bald-headed, perhaps not necessarily very glamorous, perhaps pot-bellied even, or whatever, beer-bellied, should I say. But the women are expected to be a lot more glamorous and thin and good-looking, and it's a different image.
Unsurprisingly, it's largely the tabloid press who've raised the public's temperature to few water scorcher levels on the Weathergull front. And when they say front, they're not talking isobars.
Hello, good evening. For the
if ITV's weather girls have got better fronts than the BBC's, important questions are asked about how our licence money is being spent. The BBC, of course, refuses to rise to this bonkability challenge. Well, almost. Helen Young, the new addition to the BBC's weather team, has been put into the hands of a top Hollywood stylist for a full meteorological makeover.
It's quite strange having someone telling you how you should look, what looks best on you. And it does get a bit irritating from time to time when you're being prodded around and preened, and especially when I had to have my hair cut. I lost 2.5 inches off my hair, and I was really quite sad about it. I didn't want to have my hair cut.
I wouldn't want to be restyled. I'm perfectly happy the way things are, and I'm perfectly happy that my wife loves it as well. I wear smart clothing. I pay a lot of money for my clothing. My hair, as I say, it might be a little bit long on occasion, but it actually suits me being a little bit long rather than a little bit short. So if someone came along to try and change that, I would be a little bit aggrieved, actually.
But weather forecasting isn't just sex and glamour. It's passion, too.
We're passionate people about the weather. If we weren't, we wouldn't be in the job.
The weather never bores me, and in Britain especially not, because it's so different. I mean, people always think it's raining, but they couldn't be much further from the truth, really. In Britain, we perhaps have the most interesting weather of the whole world.
I like the changes. I like to see extremes. I want to see, my favourite one will be a cold front coming down across the country, bringing in much colder weather and changing the rain to snow. And then you can look out the window the next morning, got it right. You know, there's 3 inches of partly cloudy on your doorstep.
If the weather is unsettled, you can show different graphics. You can show rain, sleet, snow, sweeping across the board, sweeping across the country. And that makes you excited, really, in a perverse sort of way.
And that's the true appeal of the weather forecast. Come rain, sun, snow, sleet, sex, or Scots accent, what you end up with is a calming daily ritual presented by committed and contented devotees to the cause. Weather forecasters belong with that rare breed of Patrick Moores, David Bellamy's, and Barbara Woodhouses, genuine enthusiasts who are not afraid, despite their awkwardness, quirkiness, and natural reserve, to celebrate their passion.
And that's the weather.
Happy birthday, weather.
Everywhere you go, always take the weather with you. Everywhere you go, always take the weather. Everywhere you go, always take the weather with you. Everywhere you go, always take the weather with you.
I think it's brilliant, finally enjoy it.
I think it's good that the audience get to say what they think.
Sometimes the public get a cut a bit short, but most of the time they get their view across.
They have to answer truthfully then, because the audience won't let them get away with any rubbish.
In the first question time of the new year, members of the public will have a chance to debate with the Chancellor, Kenneth Clark, with John Prescott of the Labour Party, with Paddy Ashdown of the Liberal Democrats, and Anne Robinson of the Institute of Directors. So join me for question time this Thursday, 10:25, BBC One.